So welcome again to today's session called Animal Architects. My name is Misha and I work with Early Bird, which is a project under the Education and Public Engagement Program of Nature Conservation Foundation. We work towards creating and disseminating creative educational content to introduce people to birds. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Manjari Jain. Thanks a lot, Manjari, for joining us today. A little bit about Manjari. Dr. Manjari worked for many years in the rainforests of Western Ghats on nocturnal insect communities, but has now returned to her first love, which is birds. Her work is primarily focused on social birds to understand the evolution of communication and social behavior in animals. Although primarily interested in crickets and social birds, Manjari has also worked on fishes, bats, and moths. She is currently based at ISA Mohali and remains actively engaged in communicating her research to public, especially kids. And today she is going to introduce you to homes and other structures that animals build. And after Manjari's talk, like I said, we also have Laboni Roy with us, who is an educator and designer with NCF's Nature Curriculum team. And Laboni is going to do a fun interactive activity on animal homes after Manjari's talk. And once the session is over, we will open the floor to your questions. And like I said before, your microphones have been muted. So if you have any queries, please type them in the chat box. So without further ado, let's begin. Manjari, over to you.
Okay. So hello everyone, and thank you for joining. This is hopefully going to be fun for everyone. Given that we are all home quarantined, I thought talking about homes would be the best idea, and not just about homes, but also about how animals build those homes and associated questions. So yes, once again, I'm Manjari from ISA Mohali, and I really hope that there's a lot of young naturalists and explorers who have joined in, because the talk is really targeted towards you guys. So we all know that the home is a place where we feel comfortable, secure, and it is very important for our survival and to ensure that we are protected from the external environment. If it is too hot, like it is in Mohali, you can scurry back to the comfort of your home. But the same goes for animals. Animal homes are also crucial for their survival. And the question that arises when you think about animals living in homes is that, how do they build these homes, and what kind of skills are required for them to build these homes? Do they learn, or when do they learn these skills? Do they learn at all, or do they know it somehow just as they are born, or do they sort of this skill sort of exhibits only at a certain time of their life? So these are the kinds of very interesting questions that you don't have to be an adult scientist, you can be a young scientist and think about all of these questions. And the beauty of being in a country like India, being in the tropics, all of these interesting questions are scattered around in our backyards. So all you need to do is to go out in your backyard and look at the world around you, the natural world around you. It will throw so many questions to you. So today let's talk about animal homes and the questions regarding them. So the first thing that comes, at least to my mind, maybe there's a bias because I am biased towards birds, are homes that birds build, and these are nests, of course, we know. And in fact, if you ask me what are the features that characterize a bird, so of course, the most important feature is the presence of feathers. You all know that birds have feathers, but they can also have beaks. But we also know that not only birds have beaks, there are some other kinds of animals who have beaks, right? Duck-billed platypus, maybe you know about it. But another thing that comes to our mind when we think about birds is that they fly, or at least most of them do. And that they lay eggs, and they lay these eggs in the nest. Okay, at least this is what comes to our mind when we think of birds. At least this is what comes to my mind. And with that, I think that I should start about animal homes from bird homes. So if you think of bird homes, the kinds of questions we can ask, and I'm starting this talk with questions just because I would like you all to ponder about these questions during the talk, after the talk, that why do birds build these nests at all? The obvious answer, I would imagine, is to take care of the young ones. And you can sort of make a mental note about this and write it for yourself. Why do you think that these birds are making these homes for, or what are they? Why are they making these nests? What are these homes made of? So what kind of material is being used for making bird nests? And where are they building these nests? So if you really had to go out, walk out in your surroundings in, say, for instance, your garden or in a park, where are you likely to find these nests? So I think there are some very obvious answers that are coming to your mind already. So I would like you to sort of remember all of this, these obvious answers, and then through the talk and after the talk, see how much of it is upheld, or if you have sort of found, discovered something new. Also, who is going to build these homes? Is it going to be the male birds or the female birds, or the boy birds, if you like, and the girl birds, if you like, or both participate to build the homes, okay? And how do they build them? What kind of tools are required? And what kind of skill and ability to think, if you like, so cognition, what kind of, what facilitates their ability to make these very interesting homes, the nests, okay? So with respect to material, I'm imagining that the first thing that comes to your mind when we think about a bird nest is a bunch of twigs that are sort of put together, right? But I would like you all to sort of see and ponder about this, and even hunt for these if possible, at a safe distance without disturbing the birds, that the kinds of materials birds use to make their nests are very diverse. And also it matters and depends upon which part of the nest these materials are being used for. Is it for the outside? Is it for the inside? You will notice if you find a fallen nest somewhere, or if you see a picture of a nest somewhere, you will find that the exterior and the interior look very different. Typically the inner side of the nest is much smoother, and often this is also lined with some soft kind of material, okay? But the kinds of material birds use is fairly diverse, and I would like to share that with you. So lichens, I hope you know what lichens are. So these are this symbiotic organism between two different kinds of organisms, if you like. So lichens are, okay, you can find them on the barks of trees. So many birds use scrape off lichen and use it for adding this material to the nest. For instance, on this particular one, you can see how the exterior part of the nest is covered with lichen. They also use moss. So around the rainy season, you know, our lot of stone walls and surfaces are going to very quickly get covered with moss. And this moss is one of the important material used by birds in their nests. Something which is, I think, absolutely fantastic and extraordinary is that the birds use spider webs in their nest, not just in the inner lining, but also, for instance, hummingbirds use spider webs for making these very compact nests. The nests almost seem like there's little space. You can see this this image is an image of a hummingbird nest. And there is almost, it seems like there is not enough space for the young ones when they hatch out of the eggs. But what the spider web allows, so the silk of the spider is very interesting, and it has a certain kind of properties which make it very elastic and yet very strong. So when the hatchlings come out, the young ones come out, so the nest actually practically can expand to accommodate all. So that is what is absolutely incredible, and if you like, the birds know, okay? So they are collecting these very interesting material to make their bird homes. Some other not so obvious material that I would like to share with you that birds use for making their nests are mud. For instance, this house martin here has made a nest which is made mostly out of mud. So we all know there are mud houses. People also live in mud houses, but there are birds that do not use more vegetation. Unlike the tailor bird here, the next image you can see that a leaf has been rolled in, and there is some there are various kinds of twigs and other vegetation material which has been lined inside the cavity to make the nest. That is the tailor bird. But the martin, the house martin, on the other hand, makes the nest out of mud. I would like to ask if anyone knows what the third. This is also a nest. Does anyone know what this nest is? The yellowish thing. Can we have a yes and no? Can you guys vote on this? How many of you know what this is? So mostly I'm getting no's, 10, 11, 12 and counting. There are 4 yeses. Okay, so largely it seems to me that most people do not know what this is, and which is what is good, because if you already know all the things, then you know what I'm saying is not going to be interesting. So it's fine, it's good, great that you don't know. What this is basically, it's a nest of a bird called edible nest swiftlet. This swiftlet is found, this particular nest is of these birds found in the Andaman Nicobar Islands, and it is completely made of the saliva of the bird. There is no plant matter in this. So in some sense, it is like a castle made out of the spit of the bird. And one would imagine this is fairly disgusting, but no, people actually eat these nests. And it is a delicacy in many parts of Southeast Asia. This is a delicacy, and this has caused an enormous amount of decline of this bird, because the people were harvesting these nests to make these nest soups, and which are exotic soups. But this caused a severe decline of these birds that you make these saliva nests, okay? And now, of course, conservation measures have ensured that, you know, we keep all of that in check. But the interesting part being, this is completely made of spit and we eat it. Okay. So, if you think of, so those were like different kinds of materials. So this is just to sort of impress upon you that it's not just made of twigs and grasses. Nests can be made of all different kinds of things. But what would these nests actually look like, or the shape of the nest, is also something which is extremely diverse. For instance, there are some birds which just bury the eggs in a mound of decaying vegetation. So here in this case, a megapod. And you can see it is just sitting on top of a mound of what seems like decaying vegetation. So the egg is inside that mound. And it provides insulation, and it also provides certain kind of a temperature, controlled temperature, certain kind of environment which is conducive or favorable for these eggs to hatch, because these birds do not stay on to provide care for the chicks. Okay, so they lay these eggs in these mounds, cover them with this decaying vegetation, and off they go. Okay, but these chicks then hatch out and then they are on their own. But this nest, which is a very rather rudimentary and simple nest, is enough for the chicks to hatch out from the eggs very safely. On the other hand, you can see these are flamingos, which have made this mound type nest. Many birds actually make such mound type mud nests. And the advantage, so basically it is just a pile of mud in which there is a certain depression in the middle where the female then lays the egg. And what is the advantage of having these mound nests? Basically, you will be in an island of water, if you like. Okay, so your mud mound is surrounded by water, and that provides protection. So wolves and other terrestrial predators will not be able to access your nest. If you were just laying your eggs on the ground, then you become very susceptible or vulnerable to these predators. So flamingos have found a way out by making these mud mound nests near water bodies. Other kinds of rudimentary eggs, you can see all around you, there are some various birds that, as I said, nest on the ground. So if you just walk around, so these, I don't know if you can see the egg here, this is a pile of twigs and grasses in which there are 4 eggs that have been laid. The egg, the outer part of the egg is mottled, so you can't see it very easily. The same bird species also lays egg on just cracked mud and stones, okay? And the bird that is doing this ground nest, this is a red wattle lapwing, you can see here with its chick. And these eggs, although on the ground, are very hard to find. They are very very nicely camouflaged. So you can, although they are on the ground and in some sense susceptible to the predators, even like dogs, but since they are so nicely camouflaged, it is going to be very hard for the predator to find these eggs in these nests. So rudimentary scrape nests just made out of twigs and stones. A little, the building and the architecture gets a little more fancier and complicated. There are birds, and this is the largest variety of birds that make these kind of nests. These are called cup nests. And you can see the nest is actually looking like a cup. So on the left side, you have a paradise flycatcher, which has built a nest, a cup. It's a shallow cup, and it is made up on the tree. It is no longer on the ground, so we have now climbed up. On the right, you have the reed warbler, and you can see the way that these nests are anchored. One, of course, the nests are different because one is a shallow cup, the other is a deep cup. But the way they are anchored to the substrate is also very different. So in case of the reed warbler, what it has done is simply tied these vegetation material to these blades of reeds, so grasses if you like, and it just ties it around these reeds to and lets the whole material sort of dry and it hardens, and this is what provides the shape and the strength to the nest. So these are cup nests. You may not see the cup nests of paradise flycatcher or the reed warbler easily, but what you will be able to see very easily is this cup nest of a very, very common bird called the red-vented bulbul. Red-vented bulbuls are found practically all over India, so except in some parts. But if you just walk around, you will be able to see. It is a bird which is somewhat brownish, mottled brown in color, which has a black head and has a sentry-like little crest. And this slide shows the different stages of nesting for a bird. Okay. So first they make the nest. This itself is time consuming. They take some time to make the nest. Then the female lays the eggs in it. And then the eggs hatch. There will be nestlings, hatchlings, fledglings, and the birds gradually develop. Okay. In this particular case, the young ones, the eyes are all closed. They're completely dependent on the parents to provide. So the nest is really crucial for their survival. Okay. Everyone must have seen these pendant-like nests of the Baya weaver. Yeah, this is an absolute marvel if you think about it, the structure of the nest, the way the entry and the exit of the animal, of the bird is structured, how the eggs are going to be placed inside the this pendulum, if you like. This is absolutely stunning for me, and I'm sure that you are also amazed by this structure. Many of you must have seen this also all around you. So here, the Baya weavers, in case of the Baya weavers, it's always the males that make these nests. And what the females do is basically they come and inspect these nests, and they give it a good look, and then they decide for themselves, okay, is this good enough or not? Do I like this nest? The males better do a good job, because if the males have not made a good enough nest, which the female actually inspects very carefully, she goes inside the nest, checks the lining, goes outside, looks at the structure of the nest, everything. And she can just simply fly off to another male if she does not like the nest. And in which case, the male must now restart from scratch, okay, and make another nest. In fact, the males spend some time making what they call as training nests, okay. So they train themselves with some nest building before they actually do make the final version, which the females are very likely to reject, so they better do a good job. So these are pendant like nests of Baya weavers. On the other hand, you can see another hanging nest. So this is of a sunbird, again a bird that you can see everywhere. It's a purple sunbird, and they have this very interesting nest architecture. And typically what looks like sort of garbage or dirt hanging from the bottom of the nest, okay, this is something that makes the nest in some sense invisible to us. But for the bird watchers, this is what, or at least I watch out for this. When I'm looking for sunbird nests, this is what I really look for. Okay, so these are another kind of nest structure, if you like. Then, of course, there are platform nests. So you have seen the nests of storks. Those of you who have seen water birds, you would have seen them make this somewhat shabby looking platform nests, which are also made by raptors or birds of prey. On the right hand side, you have a pheasant tailed jacana. It's a water bird, and you can see the eggs on this nice platform floating nest. Okay, so the nest is actually floating on water, and this is what on which the bird then lays its eggs. Okay, so now, last but not the least, we also have cavity nesters, and these are like you can think of them as high rises, okay, or the apartments at the on the top floors, if you like. So these are, many trees have natural cavities, and many birds use these cavities to nest. But there are some birds who actually make their own cavities, or they're making their own nest, and these are called primary cavity nesters. And on you can see the woodpecker here and the barbit here, who's at its nest. They actually make their own nests, okay, and when they vacate these nests, and sometimes they are driven away by other species. Secondary cavity nesters like parakeets, owl, they occupy these nests or these cavities for their raising their own young ones. So there are many species of secondary cavity nesters. There are also natural holes in large trees, which are used by birds like hornbills. So even dead and decaying trees can have a lot of cavities which are used by birds to nest inside, and which we must keep in mind before we start felling these trees, thinking that okay, they are dead and gone, so we should just get rid of them, because they have their own role to play in the ecosystem. Okay, and certain kinds of birds, such as the hornbills, they absolutely require these natural cavities, which are present only in certain kinds of trees of a certain size, and therefore making it vital that we have all these kinds of trees available if these birds have to survive, which is sort of in danger when we start logging these trees for clearing trees for our own needs. Okay, so with that, I just want to remind you that the bird nests have endless forms, and they have endless locations where they have their nests. There are cavity nesters, there are nesters who nest on tree, on the ground, who have mound nests, there are dome nests, there are cup nests, all kinds of nests, okay? Endless forms, absolute fantastic variety. I have a question now for you all. So do all birds make their nests? Can I get a yes and no? Do all birds make nests? So it's great to see it's an overwhelming no. So not all birds make nests is fantastic, yes. In fact, well, some of you, or at least the adults seeing the presentation, would have probably seen this movie. The name of the movie is One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. But the point is that there is no cuckoo's nest. The cuckoo does not make its nest, okay? Many species of cuckoos are actually brood parasites, and brood parasite basically means they are unwelcome guests in someone else's nest, okay? In this case, you have a cuckoo fledgling. You can see it is much, much larger than the host. This is a reed warbler who is feeding the cuckoo. And you can see the nest is so tiny and small. Remember the reed warbler nest, it's a very small compact nest, and the cuckoo laid its egg in this nest, and now the reed warbler is having to raise the, so it's a foster parent to another bird's babies. So these are called brood parasites. There are some other birds who make this fantastic, beautiful, almost a work of art, one would say, nests, which are called bowers, and these birds are called bower birds. And the important thing here is that these nests that these male bower birds build are not for laying eggs. Okay, so not all nests are used by birds to lay the eggs. In fact, what these bower birds, there are different species of bower birds that are found in New Guinea. What they do is the males make this extravagant structure, very ornamental, and they collect. So each species has its own peculiarity, the nest shape, and the kinds of things that it decorates, if you like, the nest with. Okay. And these decorative items could be berries, it could be flowers, it could be shiny objects of a particular color. So in this case, you can see one individual has fancies blue color, while someone else, another one, fancies pink color. These are the males who are building this fantastic nest, and they are decorating it. Then the female then comes and inspects these nests. Based on this work of art, the female then makes only one decision, whether she should mate with this male or not. And once she decides to mate, she does not lay her eggs in these nests. In fact, what she does is she makes her own very inconspicuous nest. These bowers are really huge structure. You can see it from far away, but this is not where the nest eggs are laid. Okay, the female makes her own nest and lays the eggs there. Okay, so this is a nest which is not for the young one, but more so like an art gallery, if you like. Okay, and now the final thing that I wanted to ask about, wanted you to think about, is how are these birds making this incredible variety of different kinds of very complex looking fancy nests? All the tools that they have is just their claws, their feet, and their beak. This is all they have. They have nothing else. Okay, they don't have mortar and pestle and all kinds of, you know, various fancy equipment that we use for building our nests. They don't have all of these things, right? They have their beak and they have their claws, and just by these tools they build this nest. So now one would imagine that, well, there are many different birds who have different kinds of beaks, and therefore hence we have different kinds of nests, right? Does that sound like a good hypothesis? That there are different kinds of beaks, and so we can expect that these birds with different kinds of beaks will have different kinds of nests. Can I get a yes or no here? Birds with similar beaks should have similar nests. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Great. So most of it, I'm getting mostly yeses here. The problem, however, is that is not the case. In fact, several birds who have very similar beak shape have very different kinds of nests. Okay. And then we ask the question, what are these different beak shapes for? Well, these different beak shapes have evolved for the diet, the kind of food that these birds eat. Okay. It is not because they are making these kinds of nests. Okay. The beak has not evolved for nest making, but it is more so for the kind of food that they eat. So whether this is insectivore, do they fish, do they do surface probing, do they dive in deep into the flower for finding nectar, that is what determines the beak shape and not nest making. Okay, so that is about tools, but how do they know, how do they learn, from where the skill is coming? Do they how do they know how to make this complex architecture, if you like? The thing is that despite centuries of bird watching and centuries of bird nest observations, we still don't understand. We don't understand what exactly allows the birds to make these very complex or rudimentary. So what determines whether it's going to be a complex or a, so of course there is certain thing about the species itself, but what exactly about its ability to think, if you like, so it's cognitive ability that allows it to make these very fancy structures. There is some evidence now, very recent, which says that there's certain kind of structures in the brain, the folds and stuff, which may be correlated. We still, this is all again very recent stuff, but still don't know what exactly allows birds to make these very fancy complex nests. Okay, so this is just to say that there's enough. It's not like all questions have been addressed. There are many questions about behavior, animal behavior, that we still don't understand. And also remember, behavior is something, an aspect, a trait of the animal which will not leave any fossil records. You're not going to have fossils. You will have the shape of the beak, but you will not have a fossil record for the behavior. Okay, so that is an additional difficulty. Okay, so now I just wanted to have move away from birds and very quickly address some other architects. And this is a special request by Vihan, and I'm addressing his question. How do bats make their nests, or where are bat homes found? Okay, So of course, a lot of bats roost in man-made structures or abandoned buildings and things like that. They also roost in trees, cracks in the mud walls, all of these things. But there is this bat called the Indian short-nosed fruit bat. You can see the mother with the pup here in this picture, which was taken in Kudremukh in South India. So the pup is latched onto the mother. And what the males do is they cut, chop, and trim the leaves of certain trees and certain other structure of the plants to make tent-like structure. And this tent-like structure is which is then protected by the male. And then many females visit those tent-like structure and they are given shelter and they can choose to stay with the male in those tents. Okay, so these are tent-building bats. Of course, females may decide to not stay in the tent anymore. It is not conducive, or they don't like the tent anymore or the male anymore. They of course move out. So these are tent-making bats. These are fruit bats. They don't eat insects. They eat fruits. Okay, in this very nice picture by Rajesh, you can see how in this nice pile of fruits they have made a nice tent out of this. Okay, with that, I think I'm done with most vertebrates, and there are these creepy crawlies which we don't want to talk about mostly, but I would like to talk about. I would like to talk about web builders, and you know what web builders are. So whether for those who know what spiders are, can you tell whether spiders are insects or they are not insects? Are spiders insects? Okay, almost roughly equal so far. Okay, almost 50-50, yes, no. Tilting towards yes now. Okay, interesting. So spiders are not insects, okay? They are invertebrates, which means that they do not have a vertebral column, but they are not insects. Insects have, so the easy cheap trick to identify insects, they have six legs or three pairs of legs. Spiders have eight, okay? So these are the web builders. And if you ask a software engineer that, you know, for web development, is Silk better or Chrome better? There will be some debate about this. But in the animal world, for web building, there is no doubt about it. Definitely Silk. For building webs, we need Silk. And spiders are masters of these web building. This is a tunnel spider, a funnel spider. You can see it's made a funnel-like web. Then this is a typical web that you will see everywhere all around you. You don't have to look too far to find these webs. Okay, this is an orb-weaving spider which has made this kind of very nice, interesting circular web. This is not snow, but this is sheets of spider web. Okay, and these are sheet webs which have covered entire landscapes. Okay, this happens every now and then in the spider season. And these spiders, the silk that they use, are this is produced from a part of a specialized organ in their abdomen. And how do they make these very interesting web is what let's think about. So basically what they do is they have two anchor points. Okay, they start with two anchor points. So they put a bridge line between the two anchor points. You can see there's a nice schematic here where you can see how they first make a bridge line. And some loops here and there to ensure they can travel from one place to the other. And then they go down. As they go down from the abdomen, this silk comes down, finding the third substratum for the third anchor point. Okay, so once they have their enough number of anchor points, what they start to do is they start to attach the center with these anchor points. Okay, so they move from outside to inside and attach the center with these anchor points with this radial spokes, if you like. Many radial spokes are added to these various anchor points, and then they start the work. What do they do? From the center outwards, they start making what we call as an auxiliary or a non-sticky spiral. Then they reach the outside. Once they reach the outside, they typically wait for a bit, and then they start making their sticky web, okay, which is from outside to within. I will just for a moment, I'll just share another screen, a nice video which I found, and I thought it'll be interesting for the younger audience to see this. I hope you can hear this. So yeah, that was how these spiders, invertebrates, are making these very fantastic structures, and these are very stable structures, okay? And a lot of interest in the material, the spider silk itself is there in scientists. In fact, in ICER Mohali itself, there are people who are working on spider silk to see how, to understand the properties, number one. So this is Professor K.P. Singh. And to understand how this silk can now be used to build certain kinds of nanostructures, which can be used in all kinds of machines and stuff, given that it is elastic, it has a very high tensile strength, so on and so forth. So this is something which is interesting for not just the casual observer or the naturalist, but for serious scientists as well. Okay. So then this was the webs of spiders, but coming to insects, the other group of organisms with which I have worked extensively, I would like to just talk very briefly about three insects. So the ants, the termites, and the bees. What ant nests, you will see ant nests if you walk around any park or any garden. You will find these modest looking structures on the ground, which sort of does not reveal much, except that you will see some tiny little ants, you know, scurrying around, and one would not imagine what actually lies within. But there is someone who has examined the internal structure of these ant nests, underground structure, by pouring in some liquid metal and orthodontal cast into the nest. And what we can see is the absolutely fantastic, amazing internal structure, the architecture of the nest. From outside, it does not reveal much, but inside, you see, this is the nest of the Florida harvester ant, okay? And you can see that there are vertical shafts that go down, and there are offshoots where there are tiny chambers, okay? These different chambers are used for different things, okay? Depending on the depth from the ground, all of these things are important. These are some other examples of some other ant nests, so subterranean castles, if you like, made just out of digging out dirt, okay? So this is what the ants are building, and we don't, most of the time, we are not even aware of this. This is the Indian harvester ant, and you can see outside, it is not a very modest looking nest even outside, but what lies inside, we don't even know, okay? At least I do not know. This is another ant's nest, and people, this is in Argentina, this is a leaf cutter ant where people dug for several meters underground, and what they discovered, uncovered this huge colony of underground colony with the highways connecting different chambers. Absolutely fantastic, spectacular. This is one ant nest, okay? Termites, on the other hand, you will see them around. I don't know how many of you have seen termites, but if you walk around, you will be able to see these termites. And these termites, if you look at the internal structure of the termite mounds, then you will see that there are this cavity-like things which lead to a central chimney, okay? If you see the rightmost picture, you can see all the chambers and these little funnels, if you like, they are sort of leading to a central chimney, which is allowing ventilation. And in fact, this is something that has inspired some architects. In this case, this is the Eastgate Center, which was inspired by the ventilation system of the natural ventilation system of the termite mound, as to how cool air can be circulated and warm air can exit from this chimney-like structure. Okay, so this is bio-inspired sustainable architecture. Last but not the least comes the honeybees. And I just want to say one thing about the honeybees. Everyone has seen honeybees, I'm sure. You have seen the beehive at least from far. But if you see from close enough, you will see that these cells are hexagonal in structure. Those of you who know what a hexagon is, okay? Those of you who do not know, you can just see these, this pattern of, you know, sort of triangles sort of put together, pasted together, and the center has been rubbed off, if you like. This is a hexagon, has six sides. And they have been making these hive cells, which are hexagonal, and they have been doing it for millions of years. But we did not understand, at least until 1999, why these hexagonal structures? I mean, why do hives have these hexagonal structures? And it took a mathematician to solve this, and he showed that basically a hexagonal grid, so if you have hexagonal cells which are packed close, then they're sharing walls, if you like, that is a most efficient way to partition any given area into equal regions, or equal any given region to equal areas. Now, if you think of a cell which has a certain volume that needs to be divided, then you can think of a cell which is hexagonal in structure all throughout. So this is going to be the structure which requires the which has the least total perimeter. You can just calculate it for yourself. So you can have squares next to each other, circles next to each other. So if you have circles next to each other, what happens is there are gaps in between, which means that if the cells were circular in nature, which is the easiest configuration, they would have to fill the gaps between these cells with material. And what is this material that they're using? The material that they're using is wax. And wax is expensive. The bees produce their own wax, okay? And they require a lot more, so they have to process a lot of, first of all, make honey from collecting nectar from millions of flowers to get just 1 ounce of wax, okay? So it is fairly expensive. So they're trying to, one could imagine that it is in their interest, if you like, to economize the amount of wax being used, and they do so by making the cells hexagonal, which will require the least amount of packing material. Okay, so the question being, of course, this is just a screenshot. I don't expect you to read this formulae. This is a screenshot of the paper by Thomas Hales, and there's a lot of complicated math that is going on, and he's figured this out that, you know, hexagon is the best way to pack stuff with the least amount of material being invested. So the question really being that, were these bees who have been making these hives for millions of years doing all this complex math to make their hives? And I leave you to think about this. How did they figure out all of this math? How did they make their cells to be absolutely the most efficient possible way? I will leave this question to you to ponder about. With that, thank you very much. I hope you will explore the outdoors whenever you can go out, maintaining social distance. And the joys of being in the tropics is that you don't have to go too far to find these animal homes around you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Manjari. I hope we all learned a lot. And I'm sure we have a lot of questions as well. But before we open the floor to questions, I'll invite Labuni from the Nature Curriculum team at NCF to share her screen and start a short activity that she's prepared for all of you. I hope you all have your pen and papers ready. Over to you, Labuni.
Hello, can everyone hear me?
Yes.
I'm sorry, there was a little bit of a technical error, and now we're ready to go. Hi, I'm Labuni, and I work with the Nature Conservation Foundation's Nature Learning Team. And right now, we're going to be playing a small game. I'm sure that we've learned a lot from Dr. Manjari's talk, and I certainly have learned a lot, and there's a lot of interesting things now to look at with a new perspective. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen, and what we'll do is, I hope everyone has their pen and paper ready. We're going to be playing a small matching game, and I'm just going to share my screen now. Okay, I hope everyone can see my screen. So we're going to be starting the matching game with a setup like this. So in the top row, we'll be seeing a different list of animal homes. In the bottom row, we'll be seeing the different list of animals. Now, in the top row, we'll have the naming of the animal homes as A, B, C, D, as you can see. And in the bottom, they'll be jumbled. Now, the aim of the game is for you to match the letters with the corresponding numbers. So we're going to have three rounds. And the first round is animal homes and animals that you may have seen inside your house. So let's start. And remember to write down the answers in your notebooks or on your piece of paper that you have with you. Okay, let's start. So here in the top row, you can see some interesting structures that you may or may not have seen in your house. And at the bottom row, you can see some different animals. Now your task is to match which animal made which home. So could it be, for example, 2 to A? Could it be 4 to D? I'm giving you 30 seconds to guess. So please start. Okay, 30 seconds are up. Let's see what the answers are. So here we have the matching. As you can see, the answers are 4 to A, 1 to B, 2 to C, and 3 to D. So a little bit about all these different homes and who makes them. The first thing, which is A, you may have seen this on the walls of your house or in your bathroom. It's a cocoon made by something called a case worm moth larva. So this larva, what it does is, this little worm that you can see, it goes and collects all these little pieces of gravel and sand and makes a cocoon for itself so that it's protected. And interestingly, it makes it so that it matches the background so that it's harder for you to see. So for example, if you have a white wall, you'll be seeing, you'll probably see a white case worm cocoon. So these larva are masters of camouflage and they design their own cocoons according to whatever materials they find around them. The second pairing, which is B to 1, is, I'm sure that you may have seen this in your house or in your school libraries or something like that. These are tunnels made by a silverfish. A silverfish is a small insect that loves chewing on starch, which is found in paper. And what they do is they go inside your books and they make little tunnels, and that's where they live and lay their eggs. Of course, we don't like silverfish very much because they do harm our books. But as you can see, they make very beautiful patterns. So that's one thing we can learn from silverfish. The third pairing, which is C to 2, is a sheet web or a flat mesh web. You may have seen these in the corner of your houses and in the corners of walls. You can see these small, small little webs made of spider silk. And that is made by somebody called the flat mesh weaver spider. These spiders are very, very, very small. You may not even be able to see them very careful, very clearly unless you look very carefully or with a hand lens. And they build these small, very fine webs. And I'm sure if you look around your house, you can see them. And the last pairing, which is D and 3, is a very interesting nest made by an animal called a potter wasp. Now a potter wasp, what she does is, and the female builds a nest, she goes and she finds little pieces of mud in her surroundings, and she carries them, and then she makes this very interesting structure, as you can see, with a little hole on the top. If you can see the hole here, it's on the top of the nest. And there she lays her eggs, and the eggs grow and hatch inside this nursery. And then later, when they're all matured and when they've grown up, they come out of the nest. Now, something very interesting about potter wasps is that they feed their babies live food. So you may see a potter wasp going towards her nest holding a caterpillar or another small insect, and she'll be feeding it to her her live young. So keep an eye out, and you might catch some of these beautiful insects in your home these are insects that can be very easily seen around our home. Okay, congratulations to everyone who, you know, participated here. I'm sure that, you know, you may have gotten a lot of the answers correct. And even if you didn't, this is a wonderful opportunity to observe things that are seen around your house and maybe learn a little more and maybe even find some different ones next time that, you know, we don't know about and you can tell us about them. So let's go on to the next round. The next round is going to be made up of animals that you may not see in your house, but you might see in your neighborhood or in your park or maybe in your school ground. So here we go. Like the same, like the last round, I'm going to give you 30 seconds to guess and please match your answers in your books. Here we are. Okay, time's up. I hope you all have your answers ready. So this is a very interesting set of animals, and actually you may have recognized one of them from Dr. Manjari's presentation. Let's see what the answers are. Here's our correct pairings. We have A to 3, B to 2, C to 4, and D to 1. Now here's a very, very interesting collection of as you guessed it, insects. They all have six legs, or rather three pairs of two legs each. And so this is a termite mound that's made by a termite. And we've also just learned about this in Dr. Manjari's session. So I'm not going to get into it in so much detail. B, the option B, might be a very interesting thing that you've seen in your gardens. These are called galls. They're little mounds made by wasps in leaves. And the wasp makes this mound and lays her eggs in it. And again, these wasps are very, very tiny. So you'll have to look very carefully to see them. And once she lays her eggs and the wasps mature and they hatch out and fly off. So I'm sure actually even, you know, you may see this in a lot of trees. You may see this in a lot of plants in your garden, maybe in your local park. And now you know what it is. So isn't that really cool? Option three is you may have seen this in, especially in mango trees. If some of you have interacted with mango trees a lot, this is a weaver ant nest. And as you can see here, what the ants have done is all together, thousands and thousands of them have pulled these leaves together and woven thin strands of silk, similar to what a spider does, and joined them together so that they form one big structure. And they all go and they live inside this. So essentially it's a tent that they make. And this is what a weaver ant looks like. It's a, she's a red-colored, you know, young lady here, and you may see them even around your houses sometimes. But these nests are very commonly found. At least I've seen them a lot in mango trees. So that may be somewhere that you've noticed it. Maybe you've noticed it and not thought about it or not realized what it is. The last one, D, is an antlion trap. Now, antlions are very interesting insects. This is the larva of an antlion. And which means it's not fully grown, but it is a very, very hungry insect and it really needs to eat all the time. So what an antlion larva does is it makes a little hole in the ground here. And this hole is cone shaped. Now, if you were standing on this edge of the hole and you slipped, you would probably fall inside, right? And that's the antlion larva's plan. This is what it plans for all the ants that come around. So what happens is ants come near this burrow and they're very interested in it. And they try and look over the edge, maybe they try and see what's happening, and they slip inside. And they slip to the bottom. Right at the bottom, the antlion is waiting there to eat them. So this is how the antlion larva traps its prey. Yeah. Okay, again, well done, everyone. No matter how many you got correct, at least you know you know some more interesting things now that you can notice next time you go out. Time for the last round. Same as the last, we'll be doing 30 seconds. And please write down the answers in your notebooks. Okay, here we go. These are going to be animals that you may see a little far from your house. You may not see them in the cities. You may not see them commonly, but maybe if you've gone on a holiday somewhere, or you know, you live in a place where these animals are found, you will be able to spot them. So I'm going to change the slide now. We have 30 seconds. Here we go. Okay, and we are done. I hope you have your answers ready. Let's see what the solved version of this looks like. Okay, so the pairings are A to 3, B to 4, C to 1, and D to 2. So these are a very, very interesting set of animals. As you can see here, we have insects, we have arthropods, we have a bee eater, and we have an arachnid. So we have a lot of variety going on here. Pairing A is a fig. You may have seen these in trees around your city as well. And these are actually home to a very interesting insect called the fig wasp. A fig wasp, what she does is, she goes and lays her eggs inside this fig. So as you can see, at the back of her body, there's a long, thin, almost like a pipe, which is called an ovipositor. It's an organ that she uses to lay her eggs. So what she does is she pierces the fig and then she lays her eggs inside the fig. And doing so, she also pollinates the fig. And this also, of course, leads to flowering. And after the eggs hatch inside the fig, they also release themselves. They chew their way outside the fig and fly off. So actually, all our figs are pollinated by these little insects called fig wasps. And you know, it's a very interesting system, because not only does the fig play a role as a nursery for the young wasp when they're growing up, it's also pollinated by the fig wasp. So this is a symbiotic relationship. They're both benefiting from each other. The second one, B, is a sand bubbler crab nest, crab hole. So if you can see right here in the center, there's a tiny little hole where the sand bubbler crab lives. And actually, what the crab eats is little particles that are found in the sand. So what the crab does is, it takes a ball of sand, like a laddu, and it eats around it, and then it tosses it over the shoulder. And that's how these patterns are formed. So you can often see this when the tide goes, when the tide is low, and you know, the water is not washing up on a beach. These are found on beaches. And the crabs will suddenly come out of their holes, and all of them will start eating, because they only have very little time to now finish their meal before the tide comes in again. And before, you know, they have to go into their holes and stay there so that they can stay safe. The third one, C, is a green bee eater nest. You can see these birds, they mate for life. So two of them live together in one hole, and that's where they lay their eggs. And they dig these holes in sides of cliffs where there's a vertical surface and there's mud. They dig this hole and then they go and lay their eggs in it. And bee eaters, the larger family of birds, often do this in a big group. So you'll maybe see like 20 to 30, maybe even more bee eater nests in one place. So next time you see holes on a cliffside, you have an idea of what to look for. The last one is D, and this is a funnel web. This is made by someone called the funnel web spiders. We have many, many species of these in India. And what a funnel web spider does is, it finds a little hole and then it lines it with its silk so that there's a deep hole. And the spider will wait inside that hole very, very quietly until an insect comes along and is curious, you know, what's inside this hole? Let me go check. And as soon as the insect goes inside the hole, the spider jumps out, catches it, and goes back in. So you may see these around when you go on trips to the countryside, or maybe if you're going for long walks to places where there's not a lot of buildings. You may see these in the ground. You may see them again on little cliff sides. So keep an eye out for the funnel web spider next time. Okay, so here we have our quiz. We've had three really, like, I'm really enjoying the participation in the chat. I'm so happy that you found this interesting. And I hope you all learned something and are now, maybe you can notice, you know, a few more things when you see them around. I'm going to take a short little time to introduce you to some a creative activity after this, which is something that we can all do in our homes. Have you heard of an insect hotel? This is what we're going to learn how to make today. And since we've learned so much about animal homes, let's learn how to make an animal home ourselves. So as we learned from Dr. Manjari's session, animals need very specific habitats to make their homes. They need a lot of trees, they need a lot of shelter, they need specific spaces. But in our cities, we don't often have this much space. Maybe because we've built so many buildings, or maybe because there are so many human-made structures, insects often don't find places to make homes. So what we're going to try and do with this insect hotel is give a home for traveling insects and give them a space to live. So basically, an insect hotel is just a space for insects to live in urban spaces. And particularly, actually, what's very, very interesting is that it can be made using a variety of materials. You can use pretty much any natural or semi-natural material. So here, as you can see, there's terracotta, there's wood, there's some little straw pipes which are made of hay. And you have a variety of materials, a variety of sizes of holes also for these insects to come and live in. It can be made in a variety of shapes, sizes, and designs. So very interestingly, you can also add this in your garden, and it'll be a very beautiful addition to your garden or to your balcony. You can also have a space for an insect to rest over there. Always having flowers and foliage nearby is a big help. And the most important part of an insect hotel actually is that not only are we giving shelter to insects who probably have not been able to find spaces to live. A very good example of this is solitary bees. There are a lot of bees who live on their own. As we saw from Dr. Manjari's presentation, there are bees that live in hives, and they build these hexagonal hives where they all stay. But there are also types of bees which live on their own, which live individually. And they often don't find places to stay. And those are very, very important pollinators. So if we want to see more green cover in our cities, if we want to see more plants, more flowers, it's very important to give spaces for these insects like solitary bees. So having flowers near your insect hotel is very helpful because it attracts them. And also, in turn, these flowers will get pollinated. So we can build very simple structures like this, which are just, it's just a piece of wood with a few holes drilled into it. Or we can even use materials like a can from our home. So this is called upcycling, where we use a waste material from our home and we make it into something else. So we can very easily use a can. We can also use old mugs. And as you can see, there are bamboo tubes inside this mug. And this is a very simple way of making an insect hotel. It doesn't have to be a big or a very simple thing, again, is just using paper, card paper, and a plastic bottle that we can find in our homes. So an important thing here is that even though we're trying to encourage insects to come into urban spaces, because we know that it's important that these green spaces are pollinated and that we have a healthy insect population in our city, we should also be careful not to interfere with them too much. And even if we're, for example, building an insect hotel, it should be in a space where the insect feels safe and we also feel like the insect is not going to maybe attack us or something like that. Because unless they are threatened, unless there is some kind of fear that they are feeling, they will not harm us in any way. So even if we're, for example, we've made a successful insect hotel and there's a solitary bee who's moved in and who's living there now, if you're going to take pictures of it, please keep a safe distance and also keep the insect hotel for like a decent distance away from, let's say, where children can reach it or where it can be moved around. Because of course, if you had a house and someone was shaking it all the time, it wouldn't be a very pleasant experience. So I'm going to quickly show you how you can make an insect hotel to encourage these insects to come to your houses, to your balconies, and to your gardens. So it's very simple. All you need is, I hope you can see my screen. Yeah, all you need is an old plastic bottle, strong paper or old paper straws. So even though paper is not necessarily a natural material, it's derived from a natural material and it's familiar enough for insects to be comfortable with. We can also use twigs or straw, so small thin pieces of wood. And if we need some rope, we can use it, and a scissor. This is all you need. And what's really great is that we can find all this stuff around our house, or if we ask around, maybe we can borrow it from our neighbors or something. And especially during lockdown, we don't have to go out and buy anything. Because most of this stuff is something that you may have found in your house, and it would be something that's already been used once, and now you can reuse it. So it's a very simple process. Keep in mind that the insect hotel should be waterproof, which is why we're using a plastic bottle for the outside layer so that rain or water doesn't get into it. It should be in a safe and stable place so that it doesn't move around a lot and so that the insect feels safe and can permanently move in and feel comfortable. Flowers and hydration are very important. If we have flowers in our garden, that's really great. We can also plant some, maybe get a potted plant. And insects are particularly attracted to yellow and red flowers. And if we leave a little bit of water, both birds and insects can enjoy that. And of course, in the insect hotel itself, we can try and have small cavities because they prefer to live in smaller holes rather than big ones. So the process is very simple. Just cut off the top part, the top that we drink out of, cut off the top part with your scissors. You can roll this paper into thin tubes and make sure the length is a little shorter than the bottle. And you can do the same thing with the straw, but just cut the straw so that it's a little shorter than the bottle. And you can stuff the bottle with these tubes and keep the twigs in the gaps in the middle. And that will also be a natural material so that insects feel a little more comfortable around it. And then the last step is just to place the insect hotel in a safe, waterproof place where it won't move around. And this is where the string comes in. You can use the string to tie it down. And then all you have to do is wait for your guests to arrive. And you have a beautiful place for them to stay, a safe place, a waterproof place. And they will come and pollinate your gardens. They will come and, you know, visit you. Maybe you can learn a little more about these insects. And, you know, I know a lot of people are afraid of insects, but this is a lovely way to learn a little more and become friends with them. So that's the end. I hope you all build your insect hotels and we'd love to see what you come up with. I hope you enjoyed this, and I'm going to hand it over to Misha now to conclude.
Thank you, Lavani, for that wonderful session. I hope you all will try this activity out at home. And if you do build a nest hotel, please do send us pictures on our emails or on our social media platforms. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Maybe not on Twitter, but Facebook and Instagram. And now we're opening the floor to questions. I'm sorry, we've overshot our time limit a little. But if you have any questions, please do type them in the chat box. Manjari, there was a question during the talk,
okay,
by Shubham, yeah. And they asked, how do birds know the art of making nests? Do they learn it or does it just come naturally?
Very nice. So most of this is what we call as innate behavior. So in some sense, it is already there. They already know how to do it. And with the right mix of juice of hormones and, at the right age, this behavior is triggered. So most of it is they already know this. And not just animals, even insects. They already know how to do this. And that is why it is important and interesting to understand what exactly is going on in that brain. I mean, how is it determined? This is very complex behavior. What determines whether the bird will be able to make a fairly complicated. So the nests are typically species specific, although within a certain species, from individual to individual, there is going to be variation, but by and large, the structure and the material use is species specific. For a particular kind of species, they have a certain kind of nest. And so therefore, there has to be something which must be common for certain groups of species and different across species. And one would, to understand all of this, we will have to understand how the brain sort of controls this, since it is mostly innate. They already know it.
Okay, before I take more questions, I have an announcement to make. So, can you see my screen, Manjari?
Yes, yes, I can.
Yeah, so we're hosting a quiz next Sunday called Are You a Wise Quacker? Which is going to be a quiz about birds. And this is for kids from the age, till the age of 18. And anyone who's 18 or younger can register for to participate in the quiz. And we have some very exciting prizes as well. I'm Garima or Abhisheka. Could anyone please share the registration link in the chat box? So if you want to test your knowledge on birds or if you want to know more about birds, please do register for this quiz that's going to happen next Sunday at 11. All right, moving on to the questions now. Deepak is asking, can you address the insect phobia expressed by so many kids here? Even my daughter is scared of insects.
First of all, it's absolutely okay to be scared. And I must tell you, I too am scared of insects. For a very long time when I joined my PhD lab, I would just not take the cricket in my hand. So I had that kind of fear. And even now, you know, there are these wasps that sort of occupy our homes, and I have a little daughter and I'm always constantly worried that one will come and bite. But just like Lapuni said, that if we do not interfere with them, they typically do not attack us. They have no reasons to. Sometimes what happens is inadvertently you have disturbed us, and only some kinds of insects can potentially bite or harm you in any way. For instance, bees can sting, wasps can also sting, ants can bite. So as long as we are not in their way, this is not going to happen. One way to sort of get over your fear is to start observing them at a distance first, get used to their presence, and take some interest in sort of handling the non-harmful ones, if you like. So don't try and handle a bee or a wasp, but you can try handling a butterfly maybe, or you could try handling a moth. Somehow everybody is scared of moths, but absolutely there's no reason why they should be scared of moths. Spiders, so the moment we see a spider, well, of course, is not an insect, but again, largely, you know, they do share our homes with us. So instead of going and swatting them, maybe we can try and observe them and if needed, handle them. So if they have occupied your table or if they've come to your bed, maybe you can gently sort of carry it away and keep it outside into your balcony. So that will help, I suppose.
If I could just add to that, I just wanted to say that even though we may be afraid of insects right now, I'm sure that even through this just short talk, we learned a lot of interesting things about them. I learned so much from Dr. Manjari's talk about insects that I didn't know before. And even if we do keep them at a distance, maybe it'll be, it's an interesting step to take to just try and know a little bit more about them. And I think once we know them a little better, I think our minds might change.
Yeah, absolutely. That's right. I think Anshuman is asking a question about wasps also making hexagonal cells. So just to address Anshuman's questions, yes, wasp Also, the paper wasps, and you will see them all over Isar Mohali and various other places. These cells are also hexagonal. But the point being that are they actually making those cells hexagonal, measuring those angles, and then, or is it a byproduct of something else? That is something I would like people to sort of ponder about a bit on their own. Also about the bird nesting, remember, there is also some amount of learning, because remember, with the Baya weaver, they use these training nests to learn how to better their skills, right? So there is a certain set of skills which is already there, but some amount of learning, all, of course, is involved in that. So that is something I would like you to bear in mind.
Yeah, in fact, I have seen a few colonies of Baya weavers where the nests are completely haphazard, and I always wondered, who are these? Maybe these are younger males practicing. So thank you for answering that doubt of mine. Shailja is asking, why does spider not stick to its sticky web?
Why does a spider not stick to its sticky web?
Yeah.
So if you observe the legs of the spider, and also it's not as though the entire thread is covered with sticky thing. There are on the thread itself, there are points at which there's certain material which is sticky. And the spider itself, if you look at the leg, it has certain kind of structures which allow it to sort of navigate this thread without itself getting stuck. So it has certain kind of hair-like structure, if you like, which allow it to escape its own, getting stuck in its own nest.
Okay, Rama is asking, is feeding birds by keeping feeders in urban areas advisable? Do they lose the skill of feeding in nature?
So I think it's a very important question, something which I have myself grappled with, and then I have found some peace. I think bird feeding, there is a cultural thing to it. Like, you know, people have been feeding birds. For instance, I grew up seeing house sparrows around me. We used to always throw some grains and things for them. So I do not think that they lose their ability to forage. But what happens as a natural consequence of bird feeding, we end up giving them very human kind of food. So we give them rotis, often which has salt in it, certain kinds of things which are processed. That is harmful for the birds, and we must avoid doing it. If you are throwing grains, which is anyway part of their natural diet, that's a different thing. But when we start giving food in which you have processed it and you have added salt, this can actually harm the birds in another way. But it is not as though they are going to forget to find their own food. And you can see that in certain seasons, certain times of the year, birds are more likely to come to your feeder. In other times of the year, no matter what you put in the feeder, they are not going to come. So that is anyway there. But you must watch as to what you are giving to the birds.
Manjari, could you also talk about maybe some guidelines we need to follow if we are observing bird nests?
Yes. So this is, I want to sort of appeal to my younger explorers, that I want you all to go out and explore insects at a distance and birds also at a distance, not so much because they're going to come and attack you, but because we must respect their privacy. So scientists do manipulate things, they do observeness and go closer, but they spend months and sometimes years in training how to do it right. Okay, so when we are learning how to observe the natural world around us, let us first start with some respect for them. Let us start with some respect for the insects, for the birds, for the animals, and give them that privacy, if you like. Especially bird nests are very susceptible to predation. And opportunistic predators like crows, they can just observe, eavesdrop on our own behavior. So they can see, they can watch us, what we are doing. And if we are going towards bird nests, and if we are they will follow us. And once we move away from there, they are going. So it is a well documented. This happens all the time. So please, especially for bird nests, please do not, and roosting areas where the birds rest, do not go too close. Do not linger around for very long. If you have binoculars, that is the best way to observe, so from a distance. If you do not have binoculars, then just ensure that when you are watching, you are not handling the nest and you are not there for too long. So you just spend a few minutes and then move on. Okay, so that is very important. I really urge all of you to bear that in mind.
Thank you. Thanks, Manjari. And I'm afraid we're running out of time. In fact, we're way over the time limit. And the questions are still pouring in. But I request either Abhishek or Garima to share our email ID and our Facebook and Instagram accounts here so that you guys can send us your questions. And Manjari will be happy to answer them later. And for next Sunday's quiz, you can get the announcement for that on our handles as well. And if you missed anything during the talk, or if you want to check out our earlier talks, they are all on YouTube on our channel. And you can go and watch them there at leisure. And yeah, so that's all for now. Thank you everyone for attending. I'm seeing a lot of tiny young faces in the participants list. And thank you Manjari again for that wonderful, beautiful, amazing talk. And yeah, please stay tuned for our future sessions. And if you make the insect hotel that Laboni showed you how to, please share the pictures with us. I'm quickly going to type our email ID in the chat box. It's earlybird@ncf-india.org. Please write to us in case you have any questions for Manjari. All right. Thanks again.
Okay, thank you so much. This was fun. Bye.
Bye-bye.